In this episode of BEA Conversations on Mental Fitness to Leadership, we are speaking with Richard Su, Chief Guru at Creative Marketing at MEP, which stands for Meeting and Exhibition Planners, based in Kuala Lumpur. It's a privilege to get to speak to Richard because he's always, you know, very busy working with people, exercising, doing lots of things for his family. And but today we are talking about something that is relatively confronting. It's called facing fear. So we know that fear can be very, very crippling, and it does affect a lot of people. And Richard, thank you so much for joining the conversation today.
Most privileged to be here. Thank you, Al, for inviting me.
Now, it is very generous of you to want to open up and to really share some of your thought process when it comes to facing fear. So I guess to start off with, perhaps if you can let us, give us a little bit of insight how fear affects you.
I think one of the things that it does to me is that it keeps me awake. Mm. I can fall asleep and I'll wake up in the middle of the night and start thinking about what are the things that needs to be done, how can I do it, and immediately I won't be able to sleep. It makes me very irritable and I won't be able to focus. I start worrying of the worst case scenarios or what will happen and how that will affect the business, how it will affect the people around me. I get very impatient. I overthink on things and I wonder why people are not as concerned. Actually, they are, but they're just probably more calm than I am. And I'm a control freak. I just start micromanaging and people get very harassed because of me.
Mm. Usually when people who have similar feelings in terms of when being confronted with fear and going through exactly what you go through, there is some reflection of self-blame, right? So in terms of building towards that mental fitness, so knowing how you can respond to fear and how you react to fear, how do you build towards mentally fit when it comes to facing fear?
When it comes to facing fear, I think, I look for solutions. I try to be a bit more solutions oriented. What can I do to alleviate the risk of this thing happening, or try to turn this negative energy into a positive? In the business events industry, I always tell my staff and my team that worrying is a good thing, because then you start looking into the details. But so we try to turn that into a positive and look at all the things that we can do to alleviate that fear of what's going to happen. Mm. Yeah. Staying calm, I think I need to do a lot of breathing exercises so that I can start thinking clearly what are the next steps, what is justified fear and what is not justified, so that we can separate reality from our own phobias.
Mm.
That's what I do.
And what are some of the triggers, and how do you communicate the triggers with those around you who will learn how to support you, and vice versa, you knowing how to support them at the moment of fear?
I think one of the things we need to do is really self-reflect. We need to look inwards and say, okay, how do you approach problems? And what are the things that you need? How do you react to situations? And because, you know, in the business events, most of us are OCD. And most of us are control freaks. So the moment when I feel like I'm losing control, that's when I know that I should be a bit more careful. I should calm down. I start thinking rationally how to react. So these are the triggers that I think it is. So when I start worrying about things, when I feel that things are not happening the way I want it, I need to take one step back and say, okay, let's be a bit more be a bit more calm and objective about things. So that's how I look at the fear. And who do I talk to? I have my team, I have my partner. I'm very blessed in that respect. When I think I can't speak to one party, I know there's somebody else I can talk to. Mm. So all else fails, I come back and I rant to my wife, and then she'll probably give me her very objective view because she's not in the business. Mm. So I have friends, a very great support system. We have our recovery group that we talk to each other regularly. So we share concerns, we share what are things that's happening, it helps to make things a bit more real for us and not so much in our heads.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So try to keep out the head space.
Oh, totally. I totally agree with you. And when at moments of fear, I think one of the key things that is, I think one of the key element in relationship that is immediately affected is trust. You start to sort of like perhaps doubt who you can trust, who you can't trust, or even like, is this feedback, you know, trustworthy. So how do you decipher who and what you can trust at the moment in time, where you know that, listen, this worrying is more about caring for the end results, and perhaps it's really just miscommunication. So how do you make sure that you continue to build trust?
I think it's open communication, being very honest with the people you're working with and telling them, if say, for example, you were very terse because, you know, something happened and you just wanted a solution and it wasn't forthcoming. So I think you need to go back and say, look, I'm so sorry I sounded that way just now, but this is my concern actually, and this is what the solutions I'm looking for, and that's where I hope you can help me with. So if they can help you, straight away you have a solution. If they can't, then we have to look for an alternative. But I think it's the openness that we need to do. Show your vulnerability. I always say, tell people, look, I don't know about these things. I need you to help me. And I think the moment people see that, more often than not, they will say, here, this is what I can do for you.
Oh, that is a sound reminder. I think it is so humbling. Isn't it a humbling journey to go back to those that you verbally hurt at the heat of the moment to say, I'm sorry that I came across that way, and how important it is at that point in time also to remain open to their criticism in terms of how they felt at the moment of the verbal miscommunication.
Okay, I was thinking of something, and then when you mentioned that, but I think when we come across to the next person and we are being very honest with them, we shouldn't appear confronting. We shouldn't go and say, you know, you did this, that's why I did this. I think you need to come from your direction. I'm not sure if I'm answering your question right now, but I think it needs to come from your insight and say, this is what I've done. I'm sorry about it. This is what I need from you. It didn't appear like you understood. So do you think you understand now and you can help me? So then it lets the other person take the ground and say, okay, I can decide what I want to do instead of being blamed. I think we have to stop the blame game.
Yeah. I mean, you answer the question, because I think many a times when we are trying to, as creative people, when we're trying to express where we are going and what we are trying to achieve, you know, the journey is not easy, right? To describe in your mind, because everything is going ahead, there's a lot going on in your mind. But, you know, at the point in time when you apologize and someone say, you actually hurt me, sometimes more fear kicks in, because we suddenly realize that, oh my God, we have been a crap person at that point in time, and we are not meant to be that way. But many a time people try to even further explain their action instead of just saying, I'm sorry, at the moment was a moment of weakness, I did the wrong thing by you, it won't happen again, but here are my triggers. I think, like you said, that open communication really helps to build mental fitness. So how do you keep mentally balanced, you know, amongst everything that is happening, the chaos, and, you know, you're in the middle of a sudden lockdown in Kuala Lumpur. So how do you keep your mind and mental wellness balanced?
You need to schedule time for yourself. There has to be a time when it's me. It can be a workout session, it could be meditation, it could be long walks, it could be just having a cup of coffee and stay out in the window for whatever timing that you have. You need to have your me time. You need to sit down and be quiet with your thoughts, be comfortable with the whole thing so your mind can settle down. And then when things happen around you, then you can look in from the outside rather than be in the middle of the chaos.
What works for you? What always works for you to calm back down?
My exercise. I need to do my workout. I need to get that stress out of my system. And you'll be surprised, actually, when I work out, I'm actually still thinking about work. but it helps the process of thinking, and you never know, you find a solution out of it.
Yeah, I think it is okay. There is no right or wrong, whether you are, you know, cooking and still thinking about work, or just walking and still thinking about work. I think to know that you have a certain choice is very, very important. So how is KL doing? Is everyone okay?
I think right now everybody is very frustrated because things were looking up for a bit. I mean, on my side, I can't speak for everybody else, but on my side and in some of the people that I'm working with, business was picking up. We were seeing some things happening for the last quarter, and suddenly this thing happened. And numbers are still climbing. So everybody is just very worried that whatever that they put into place now has to be pushed to the first quarter of next year. And I don't think a lot of us can afford that.
Can I ask, you know, for the past few months, our industry has always talking about, you know, we have to be nimble, we have to be, you know, resilient and so forth. So when you personally experienced, or you and your customers personally experienced, you know, less than 24 hour notice lockdown of your city, what have you witnessed in terms of whether it's collaboration or your relationship with the supplier? Are there flexibility? Because events this week, just you have no choice, you have to postpone.
Client, of course, was a bit panicky. She started, I had clients calling me and asking me about our options, how can we do this even though there's a lockdown. And of course, I need to consult my partners, and most times my partners will be, you're making me run all over town with just options, and I can give you immediate answers. But I think all of us need to understand that we are in the service industry, and at the end of the day, the person who's paying the bill needs to be very happy that they're gonna continue paying the bills. So we have to, on our back end, try to manage things and calm the customers down so that they know we're there for them. We are offering them full service despite whatever is happening, and that's how we can sustain our business. Because the moment they feel you're not supporting them anymore, they will go to somebody else who can.
Have the suppliers been equally supportive?
So far they have been. I've been testing their patience quite a bit, of course. As you know, when I mentioned I start micromanaging and overthinking things, they have been supportive. So it's a good thing. It's a way to build trust as well, I feel. And when you have trust, then the fear won't come.
When you, coming back to facing fear, now that you know what you know, what advice would you give Richard Hsu, the younger Richard Hsu 20 years ago, you know, as you are starting to...
Maybe 20 years ago.
20 years ago, the fiery Richard Hsu, who is a super entrepreneur.
I was totally impatient. I was totally fiery. Yeah, I have no qualms about telling people off. So I think what I will tell my younger self is be patient, be nicer, be kinder, because it will be reciprocated. But go ahead, face your fears, make the mistakes, because that's the only way you learn and move forward.
Great advice. All right, on that note, I'll let you go so that you can continue with your day. Richard, once again, thank you so much for being so open and showing vulnerability and a lot of truth in terms of how you actually are. And I think that, you know, when we know who we are and how we are at situations where we feel a little bit vulnerable and threatened because of fear, we know how to respond better as we grow older. So wishing you all the best, and if there's anything we can do outside of the lockdown, please do let us know. Take care.
Take care. Thank you so much for having me.
Thanks, Richard. Bye.